Hello, anatomy friends, this is Dr. Alsup, and in this video, we will be discussing the muscles in the posterior forearm. Okay, so this seems a bit off. I just told you we are discussing the posterior compartment of the forearm, but this clearly is an anterior view of the forearm. And the reason I have this view up here is because we have to talk about the oddball of the posterior compartment, and that is the brachioradialis muscle, which I'm going to outline right here. So the brachioradialis is the oddball, as I mentioned. It is very prominently seen or viewed from an anterior view on the lateral side. I know this is lateral because here's the first digit. So this would make this medial. So this dominant muscle here in this lateral view is the brachioradialis. It's unique in many ways. First off, its tendon does not reach the wrist, so it is its primary actions occur at the elbow joint, so not the more distal joints of the wrist and the hand like most muscles of the anterior and the posterior compartments. Additionally, the brachioradialis flexes the elbow joint, so it is unique in that it flexes, and most muscles in the posterior compartment extend. What this muscle does share in common with the other muscles of the posterior compartment is its innervation, which is the radial nerve. So in that way, it is typical and likely why the brachioradialis is considered with the posterior compartment muscles, but to be able to view it and to be able to identify it, it's much easier to see in this anterior view. Now let's actually look at a posterior view. I always try to locate the thumb first to get my bearings. So here's the first digit. So this means that this is lateral and this is medial. That's one of the things I highly suggest doing when you're getting started. So a few things here that you can see. You can see the ulna right here. I know that because this is more medial. Ulna is medial. You can also see the prominent tendon of the triceps brachii here, attaching on the olecranon, which is deep in this region. The muscles of the superficial layer of the posterior compartment are more laterally located. So they are more in this general region right here. So lateral to the ulna right here. These muscles over here are going to be from the flexor or anterior compartment. So that flexor carpi ulnaris that we weren't able to see the muscle belly very well from its anterior view. Recall, you can't see it very well right here. You can see the tendon, but you can see it from this posterior view a little bit better. So that's going to be more medially placed when you're looking at the posterior view. All right. Right about here, let me erase this. Okay, so right about here-ish, you're going to be right around where the lateral epicondyle is located. And it's important to know where that lateral epicondyle is because many of the muscles in the superficial layer will have a common proximal attachment there. And two of the muscles of the lateral compartment, so again, here's that lateral epicondyle. I am going to erase this in order to be able to draw a little bit more. So two of the muscles in this superficial layer are actually going to attach proximal or superior to the lateral epicondyle. And these are going to be the brachioradialis, which again, we saw it much more dominantly in this anterior view, but you can see a bit of it here in terms of the posterior view. And then just inferior to it, but still kind of above that lateral epicondyle region, is going to be the extensor carpi. This has got a long name, so stick with me, radialis longus. Okay, so the ECRL, the extensor carpi radialis longus, its proximal attachment is above the lateral epicondyle. So these two muscles are kind of distinctive from the other ones that do have that common attachment to the lateral epicondyle. Now, in this extensor compartment, there are two extensor carpi radialis muscles. So this longus that we just identified, that will attach more superiorly, but there is also, and I'm just going to draw an arrow to the muscle belly here, an extensor carpi radialis brevis. And as its name would suggest, it's going to be smaller or shorter than its counterpart. The extensor digitorum, so this kind of whole area right here, I'm going to outline it a little bit more. So the extensor digitorum is going to be more located kind of intermediate in this region. And you can see as we get down into this layer, it's starting to split into tendons, long tendons. In fact, there are four long tendons going to digits 2 through 5, similar to what we had in the flexor compartment with those digitorum muscles. So this is the posterior counterpart to those anterior muscles, and they will extend the digits. Medial to the extensor digitorum will be, and I'm going to outline it a little bit more, this is going to be the extensor carpi ulnaris. So extensor digitorum is kind of intermediate, the extensor carpi ulnaris really close to the ulnar bone, as or the ulna, as you might imagine. And this is going to play a role in terms of extending the wrist. All right, so this list right here is in the order of these muscles from lateral to medial. So brachioradialis, extensor carpi radialis longus, extensor carpi radialis brevis, extensor digitorum, and extensor carpi ulnaris. So if you understand this order, this starts to make a little bit more sense here. Moving to the deep layer, there's no intermediate layer in the posterior compartment. There are 5 muscles here, but we're going to focus our attention on 4 of these. Superior in this region, you're going to have a fairly wide muscle here, which is called the supinator muscle. You're not able to view the supinator unless the muscles of the superficial layer have been removed or reflected. So the supinator is deep. It does not get close to the wrist joint, and as its name would suggest, it will be a supinator of the radio-ulnar joints. Now these muscles right here are all heading towards the first digit. So again, I didn't do what I asked, or I told you to do when you first look and try to get your bearings. Here's the first digit. So you know that this is going to be lateral and this is going to be medial. So all these muscles right in this general region of the deep layer are heading for the thumb. And some of these muscles will actually pop out and are visible superficially. You can see a little bit of it right here. You can see some of the muscle superficially. But the bulk of the muscle belly is going to be deep. So the fact that you can see a little bit of them here are often called, they're often called outcropping muscles. All right, let me erase that circle I just made so I can really identify the muscles here. So the most superior of these outcropping muscles, it's going to be the abductor pollicis longus. So again, if you have pollicis or pollicis, you know you're going to the first digit or the thumb. And right next to it here, you will have the extensor pollicis brevis. So the abductor pollicis longus and the extensor pollicis brevis are kind of right next to each other, side by side. Abductor will be superior, extensor pollicis brevis will be inferior. And medial to those two muscles, you will have the extensor pollicis longus, whose tendon is also, because it has it in its name, it's also heading for the first digit or the thumb. The tendons of these three muscles are going to form boundaries of the anatomical snuff box, which we will discuss in another video. But basically right around this region here, you're going to have a region that you can see when you're looking at the skin, and you'll have some contents in there like the radial artery. Excellent. I think the posterior compartment of the forearm is the most difficult muscle compartment in the body, mainly due to the amount of muscle. So it's okay if it feels a little bit overwhelming right now. There are a lot of muscles here. So take your time to review, and as always, reach out with any questions you may have. I hope you have a great rest of your day.